I think that it's important that people understand that, you know, we talk so much about corrections a lot. That's because everyone wants to fix problems. But I really, really want people to understand the amount of work that we should be doing with our dogs. What I'm seeing a lot of people do is over talk to their dogs. That's one issue that's really, really big, is they're over talking with their dogs. They're like really talking to them to get them to do something instead of actually showing them what they want them to do and then attaching a word to it and then proofing it. So getting a dog to lie down on command is a multi-day, multi-week, multi-step protocol. Then getting them to stay in command is a multi-step protocol over weeks and lots of proofing. Getting a reliable, for instance, when we teach the word down to a dog, we don't say no to it until we've done, taught, showed them how to do it, and they've successfully done it 300 to 400 times. Like, so much work goes into these dogs. So much work. And I think what a lot of people are doing is they're not doing enough repetitions, they're not proofing their dogs, they're not proofing their dogs off distractions, and then what they're doing is they're putting their dogs in situations where they're always gonna fail, and they haven't proofed the failure away from the real world. So what you wanna do is you wanna proof the dog failing in a controlled environment so you can teach the dog what's to be expected, so you can actually do the dog training prior to the actual real life happening going on, so the dog is better prepared for the real world. Next. Hey everybody, how are you? Hello, how are you? Hey everybody, how are you? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with Joelle. We're out here in Oahu. Oahu, Hawaii. I know where we are, Oahu, Hawaii. And yep, I'm sick, but doing well. We're here for the show. Probably only do a 1 hour show tonight. It's late. Late for all of you, late for a lot of us. But a lot of good questions. A lot going on. We're out here for a seminar this weekend. We flew in yesterday. Things have been going really, really well. This is the What Would Jeff Do show. The way the show works is you ask your questions, type them into the question box. Joelle will answer them. Ask them, and then I will answer them. So the Q&A, the What Would Jeff Do show, is Q&A. Most people ask me how to stop unwanted behaviors. And then we do something called Jeff Gellman Seminars, which I tour the world. The two of us actually tour the world doing two-day seminars. We're doing six different countries in 2020. We just announced Manchester, England, and Scotland, and we're actually we're doing another one in Austin. We just left Austin last weekend. We're doing the 14th and 15th of Austin, 2020. That will be put up. So for there's about 12 people that did not get able to get working spots. Mm-hmm. I would encourage you. I know it's a year away. Buy your spots now. That will also sell out. We had 55 people at that seminar. Audit spots. Don't worry about it. You can buy that last minute. But your working spots, you want to buy. Right away. We still have some tickets available for our Oahu seminar. You go to jeffgellmanseminars.com. You can buy tickets there. But then we have our training center. I think a really good video that you put up was something you put up today, of the video that I was working that dog, teaching healing exercises, but also incorporating some sits and some downs, having another person go by. And it's like, people are seeing that video. I'm like, you do realize that barking is like 1 second of the dog's life, where other dog training, like teaching dog what to do, hundreds of hours.
Oh yeah.
So if a dog is with us for 6 weeks, it gets hundreds and hundreds of hours of positive training, reward-based training, and very little punishment. That's why I find it pretty comical that people, all these videos out there going on around about me and all this hate and so much bad, just in general, so much bad messaging about corrections. But corrections should be maybe less than 5% of your day with your dog, where rewards are going to be primarily. But without those corrections, you're going to have an out-of-control dog, and that's what we usually see. So here we go. Let's go right into it.
Britt, my German Shepherd, made me proud on our walk today. She saw at least 60 excited teens. Jeez. And was right next to me. Oh, lots teens. Of joy.
Good. Awesome. I think it's like 60 dogs. That's a lot of dogs. But teens are just as, you know, and now's a good time when school's getting out. It's a good time to proof your dog over just loud noises. a lot of distractions. We've got a playground right by our training center, which I know the staff, we can hear the kids playing, all having fun from our training center right outside. And you go, if you go to the playground, it's a great place, just on the outskirts of the playground, to proof dogs. Pretty much you want dogs to be neutral. What a lot of people are struggling with, in fact, we saw this today. We are driving back from the beach today, and two dogs that were in a pickup truck, getting out of the pickup truck to our right, ran across the street in front of the truck, a little bit down, and ran right up to two women who were walking their dogs on leashes. Now, nothing bad happened, but two unleashed dogs ran across the streets
barking
at two unleashed dogs. So there's a lot of different things that could have gone wrong. We could have hit them by our car, which would have been horrific. There could have been a dog fight, which would have been horrific. And thank God that there was only like 30 or 40 feet, because these dogs could have actually run away, or those dogs could have been reactive.
Or gotten hit by a car.
Or been hit by a car. Or there could have been a car coming the other way.
Yeah.
So there was no other car coming the other way either, towards us, which would have been, it would have been a horrific thing.
Mm-hmm.
Horrific thing. So I think it's important to definitely get some control over your dogs out there. So good for you. Good for you for doing all the hard work. Next.
Chance. My dog is dog aggressive. We can't pass another dog without her exploding. The second she looks at it, I dial up on the e-collar, but she immediately escalates into lunging and barking at the dog. What would Jeff do?
So first of all, let's forget the aggression part. Because what you described was leash reactivity. So aggression is intent to harm, will harm, but you can have a dog that's a perfect walker, but still be aggressive. So let's address the question, let's stop saying your dog's aggressive. It might be, but we're answering a leash reactive question. So how do you stop leash reacting? The last thing I want people to be doing is blasting their dogs for leash reactivity. Yes, use a remote collar for leash reactivity. Yes, you can use high levels for leash reactivity. But you want to talk about timing. Timing is important. If you miss your timing, what often happens is the dog will escalate. So what I need you to do is learn about arousal. You think you're doing it immediately. There's probably other signs that are even sooner, that are either sooner. So what I want you to do is, at the first signs of arousal, what I want you to actually do is work on a bonker. So number one, when you leave the house, what's your dog's state of mind? Start at the house. If your dog is already aroused at the house, you're gonna lose. Stop that arousal right at the house. Next.
$15 top chat.
Oh, awesome.
Is an e-collar better placed high near the shoulder on the neck or lower near the windpipe? I saw a dog try to bite the collar when it was high.
Okay, that's not because of the placements. That's just because of we have dogs that bite the collar all the time. You don't necessarily need it by the windpipe. It should be to the right or the left. But what's more important than the placement of the remote collar is the use of the remote collar. And yes, it could be used high. So if there's a lot of dog trainers out there that say, don't use the remote collar high. Unfortunately though, that's a lie. It's actually a disservice. It's a lie. Of course you can use it high. You can use it low. You can use it high. The dog determines the levels. You know, so it's the kind of thing where there's a lot of, what we really folks need to focus on is the actual art and act of training the dog. And the remote collar is a wonderful training tool for that. But remote collars don't train dogs. Food does not train a dog. Let me give you a great example. Is if I told my dog to roll over and I put food in front of it, it wouldn't roll over. Well, two of them would, because they know roll over. But one of them doesn't. So they still have to be taught. So I know roll over is, it's like, well, of course not. But well, then why would your dog sit, lie down, recall? Like, those are all other things that are maybe a little bit more natural than rollover, but there still has to be training to do something on command. So the placement of the collar ideally is here or here. Ideally. Next.
Scattered Storm, just here to say hi. I can't stay awake any longer. LOL, I'm probably going to mess things up at work tomorrow and get snapped at by my manager. Hope you guys are enjoying Hawaii. It's cold out here.
Yes, we understand. It's cold actually in Providence. Definitely, Gretch, don't get snapped at. It's very warm out here. Thank you.
Ellie, hardest dog case you've dealt with?
I don't know if I can identify one. I think just in general, when we get a lot of dogs, we get a lot of nervous, fearful dogs. So when you get a dog that is not motivated by food, no food drive, no toy drive, no play drive, no drive whatsoever, doesn't care too much about corrections, really nervous, really shy, that could be a little bit challenging. I think, you know, I don't want to make the statement all dogs are different, because a lot of it's pretty much a lot of it's the same, but there's definitely been some unique dogs that we struggle with as well. Just keep in mind, we don't historically get in happy-go-lucky dogs. In fact, most people in the dog training world, if they came into our training center, they wouldn't know what to do with these dogs. And that's not a mine's bigger than yours statement, but it's the kind of thing where I think a lot of people out there, especially people out there that are doing a lot of high drive, food drive dogs, they have no idea, literally no idea, the world that I live in. They wouldn't know what to do. In fact, I know they wouldn't know what to do because they have seen those dogs and they don't know what to do. And that's no diss to them. I actually can't do what they do. So I can't, that's not my skill set at all. So I can work a high drive dog, but what I'm talking about, like the sporting world or competition world, I'm a pet dog trainer. We tend to get dogs that are not as drivey. Now they might appear drivey, but that's arousal. You eliminate the arousal, which led to the bad behavior, you're left actually with a really nervous, fearful dog. Now we've broken the dog to the core. What I mean by that, we didn't break the dog. Don't take that out of context, please. But it's like, now you've revealed the dog. You've revealed the dog. So there's a lot of dogs that are actually drivey that you can utilize that. These dogs are not. Next.
Little Mama Mud, I made alive. Woo.
Wow, it's been a long time.
It has been a long time.
Well, you're up in Alaska and you're in a...
I thought she was in Canada.
Did I say Canada? Yeah,
you said Alaska.
You're in Canada. You're way up in Canada, though. Next.
Britt, today walking my German Shepherd, there were two German Shepherds at the gate with the owner. I gave one correction. She sat down and was calm for a full minute with all dogs relaxing.
Nice.
Then I walked past with no bark.
Awesome. Proud of you. Proud of your hard work.
Little Next. Mama Mud. So I stopped all the nonsense with the lab, who is going on 19 months, but he's acting detached. If I sit in the same room, he turns away while in place. Should I let him be?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, just let him be. I mean, you're taking it way too... You're looking way too much into this, little mama mud. And if this is... And this could be a key of what you're struggling with. It's like, so your dog goes to place and turns away from you. Who gives a shit? Seriously, who cares? When I sit at my desk and I tell my dog's place, I never, like, how are you, which way are your dogs facing? I actually couldn't tell you. Mm-hmm. I have no idea. All I know is that they're lying down and they're calm. Which way they're facing, I don't give a shit. So I'm thinking, let's flip this and be like, why does it matter? Why does it matter? Because it does obviously matter, it matters so much that you had to comment on it, that act, and you try to correct it, that actually can be make things worse. Maybe your dog just doesn't want to face you. Maybe your dog is just saying, I'm more comfortable looking the other way. It really doesn't matter. Who cares? There's no points. Your dog is lying down and quiet, right? Who cares which way it's facing? Next.
Gabe says, welcome to Hawaii, Jeff and Joelle.
Thanks, Gabe.
Hey, Gabe. Little Mama Mud, outdoors, he's up my ass. I have to repeatedly tell him to get. He doesn't explore, sniff, or play. I think it's due to the corrections for eating crap like rocks, etc.
Yeah, that can be dangerous, too. Yep.
Britt, okay, rant time. Walking by this guy, had their bike up, and I have corrected that he said he was choking my German Shepherd. I was pissed and shocked that he said I should get a choke chain.
Mm-hmm.
I told him to fuck off and I kept walking.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, choke chains choke dogs. Yeah, choke chain, I don't know. It's funny how choke chains are a little bit acceptable or more acceptable. Excuse me. Sorry, guys. I'm still trying to get over this sickness. Choke chains are more acceptable seems at prongs, mm-hmm. but choke chains actually choke the dog.
Right.
They actually cause massive trauma to the dog's neck. Mm-hmm. I mean, so does a slip lead.
Flat buckle collars.
Yeah. So I'm surprised. It's like choke chain, then you would just choke the dog. Next.
Little Mom Mud says he also isn't aware of wildlife anymore. I had a face off with a polar bear trying to get in, and a wolf stalking my house for days. He didn't smell them at all. Avoidance, maybe.
My God,
where do you live?
Yeah, she has to go out with a gun.
Holy shit!
She carries, I think, a rifle and a very powerful.
I feel like she's in the middle of nowhere. Yeah, how do you have internet to watch our show?
It's today.
Good internet.
No, it's interesting up there. Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, she lives out. Put it this way, she goes outside, there's a very good chance that she'll see a bear.
Wow.
Yeah. Yep. Definitely, I mean, she has to walk outside with a gun at all times in the winter.
Didn't answer her question. Yep. Though.
So what's the question?
Sorry, guys. This jet lag's killing me. She had a face off with a polar bear and a wolf stalking her house, and the dog didn't smell them or alert.
I have no idea. I don't know. Maybe. I doubt the dog's losing its smell. Next.
Ellie, with fearful, nervous dogs, is it best to just start basic OB and clicker training with food reward, or how do you build the confidence in a very fearful, nervous dog? Thanks.
Start the work. Just start the work. Literally, watch your affection, watch your heart, use your head, start the work. Next.
Lacey, hi guys, first time here live. I have a Jack Russell sisters that want to kill each other.
Yep.
I've had them separated 24/7. Willow's fearful and always on alert. Gypsy is constantly searching for Willow. What can I do?
Oh my God, excuse me.
We only do an hour show tonight. I'm sick.
Really bad. This is going to be annoying as fuck. I'm sure for you, it's annoying for me. Number one, you need to do a Skype with me. I'm not saying that because I want you to do a Skype. It's because you have two dogs that are trying to kill each other. It's a disservice to try to describe this. First of all, dog's always hunting for the other dog. That can be stopped. That should be stopped right now, immediately. Hey dog, stop doing that. So you actually can correct that with a bonker, put the dog in place. Number two, get that they should be crated separate. Anybody that has two fighting dogs needs to go on lockdown. Massive structure. Two crates. Two place beds. Two tie backs. Do training. Cut away affection. Most people do it totally wrong. They try to get them to be friends. Most people with two fighting dogs are like, I just want them to be friends. No, you don't. You want them not to kill each other. That's the goal. I want you to live here without ever fighting again. That's the goal. Anything above that, I will take. Because when you're like, I want them to be friends, you're not thinking rationally. And you don't go through the steps properly. You miss steps. So you're like, you're in the back of your mind, you're like, I just want you guys to be friends. It doesn't work that way. So what you do is, number one, when someone says, I've got a dog that's always looking for the other dog, I'm like, why? Why don't you stop that right now, today, this second? Leash on the dog, get a bonker, no bonk. Great, did I get the message across? Now, let me teach a place. Now the dog doesn't hunt for dogs anymore. Next.
Lacey, hi guys, first time here. Oh, I already read that, sorry. Ellie, roommate's dog landed 3 attacks on my dog, 10 plus puncture wounds and 2 surgeries. Roommate's dog is now incredibly scared and fearful of my dog, who doesn't bother her at all.
Good.
Roommate's dog is shut down.
Good.
It
should be shut out of the fucking house.
Meant to add, should we just start the work with her dog and then phase in my dog being in the room on a climb or place?
You could, or just move out. You know? It's like, I don't know. I need way more information. But first of all, it's like, I wouldn't, you know, number one, there's something going massively wrong. Number two, is your roommate just as invested in this? Are you guys on the same page? Two fighting dogs in the same house, high rate of failure. What you're gonna do is, almost like the advice I gave with the two other fighting dogs, whether they're your two dogs or the roommate's dogs, they're still two dogs. Dogs don't know that there's roommates. So the dogs just know they're living in the same space together. So what I would do is massive amounts of structure. But again, there's a lot of variables. Guys, I hope people understand the hundreds of hours we put in to these dogs with fighting dogs. Hundreds of hours per dog. And that's just for 6 weeks. Now go for a year. It's nonstop. Next.
Little Mama Mud, he looks away only when I enter a room. I don't correct. When I leave the room, he tries to break place. I put a cowbell on him so I can hear it and can immediately correct. He is better than in May.
Okay, so it's, you know, your dog, it's, you could be, I don't know what everything you're doing. So chances are, like, getting a dog to stay in place even when you leave the room, we'll call that, I don't want to call that basic, but for a dog that knows place and knows it well, that's going to be basic. So put the dog on a tie back as well. Next.
Alexandria, I cannot get my 14-month-old GSD to maintain LLW, loose leash walk.
Okay.
He will walk in a heel when corrected, but goes back to pulling after a few. No reaction to bonker.
You're probably bonking wrong, because all dogs have reactions to bonkers if you do it right. What I want you to do is, there's a spatial pressure video. There's not an official one yet. We'll make one. We'll make it, you know, we'll make one. We got to redo.
January, we'll be redoing all of our how-to videos.
Yeah,
looks like our break.
Yeah, but we're going to get some more before then, but yeah. Next.
Ellie, meant to add, should we just start the work on her dog and then phase him? I already read that already. Lindsay, hey, awesome people. How do you stop a dog from throwing themselves on the floor anytime you try to put a leash or collar on? The dog's excited and wiggly. Bonking for leashing up is helpful.
Yep.
But whenever the dog is called over, she flops over on your legs, will knock over someone that doesn't expect it.
Yeah, that's all practice behavior. Put a sleep lead on the dog, hoist the dog up. Next.
Little Mama Mud said, I have security cameras now so I can check before I let him out. The bear ended up dead. Resources got it before I had the chance.
Yep.
The wolf is dead too. Finn is super fearful and avoids people and other animals. He used to smell the black bears. Now he doesn't bother.
It's probably because you might have desensitized him to it. You know? Who knows? Next.
Lindsay. Nope, just kidding. Britt. Love you guys. You make me want to do better and try harder every day with my German Shepherd. She loves it. I feel so powerful.
Good. Proud of you. I want to do better with my life every day too. Next.
Lacey said, I stop it with a collar and she stops for the moment.
Stop what?
I think, is that the dog that flops around?
Yeah. Let me see. Put a slip lead on the dog. Yeah. Hoist the dog up. Be consistent. Also, don't talk to the dog. Silent. Next.
Oh, no. She says that's the one that has the dog that's always searching for the other dog.
Right.
So she says she stops it. No, the collar, she stops for the moment.
Right. So you're underwhelming your dog. You have not communicated with your dog that enough is enough. So do dog training. So what your people are doing is they're picking and choosing what they do. So what I want you to do is, it's the full enchilada. It's everything. All I know is this. If I had a dog that hunted for other dogs, it would never hunt for other dogs. And I just told you how I would do it. Next.
Matt, I have two dogs and the younger one bullies and pesters the older one after dinner, humping and pushing her around. Should I remote collar high for the younger one, or do you have another suggestion?
Who's the one that's pushing around?
Younger one.
Bullies. Yeah, yeah. Next.
Colleen, hi, my 10.5-week-old Aussie Doodle pulls while walking constantly.
Mm-hmm.
A quick leash pop does not work consistently. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm not popping with enough force.
Well, it's 10.5 weeks old.
One would hope she would learn not to choke herself, but she doesn't stop.
No.
If you would describe your training tips or amount of force for leash pop, thank you.
Okay, the last thing you would need to be doing is firmly leash popping a 10.5 month or 10.5 week.
Read that again. 10.5 weeks.
So 10.5 week dog, like, there's no force being used for a dog like that for pulling. The only thing we correct for is jumping, nipping, whining, and barking, pretty much. So do tons of food training, sit down, place, recall, go in your kennel, come out of your kennel, wait at your kennel. Right now, the walk, like, you're trying to perfect the walk, so you're just relax a little bit. Plus, wait 2 weeks, you'll get a prong collar on that dog. But the last thing I want you doing is taking a 10.5-week-old dog and using force by popping it. I'm highly against that. And I'm the guy that actually is forceful. Next.
Ellie, roommate's dog is now muzzled. I've suggested my roommate set up a Skype with y'all. We'll see if she does. Moving out in December, thank gosh.
Good. You know what then? Don't just keep your dog from getting into a fight till then. Next.
Lacey, should the crates be away from each other or the same room?
Same room. Put a divider between the two if you want to. Next.
Paul, looks like you have war paint on. Sunburn? No, we have terrible lighting in here.
Yeah, no, I don't. Knock it off. Yeah, I don't have I don't have war paint on at all, nor do I have sunburn. It's just that we can't...
It just looks really blotchy because, like, the shine. So, it's like, we look shiny and then, yep. Like, it's just bad lighting.
It's just bad lighting. I'm on the road. I'm on the road. Hopefully, people aren't looking for...
answers.
Hopefully, people are looking for answers and not for the cosmetics of the show. Next.
Swanty, hi, Jeff and Joelle. When is the right time to start training a puppy? I just adopted a one month old. Thank you.
Hopefully the dog's older than a month old.
Yeah. Jeez.
Because 4 weeks old is too young to own a dog. The dog should be with its litter and with its mother. If it doesn't have a mother, it should be getting, at least with its litter or a substitute mother, but someone's got to bottle feed it. So training starts, I mean, at 4 weeks old, you're really not doing anything. So I don't know if that's, is that, you've had it for a month, so now it's, so from 6 to 8 weeks on, you train your dog. You always train dogs. Always. Next.
Brett, a guy, thought it was funny that there was a leashed husky, wanted to run up to my dog. They laughed when I said crazy.
Hmm?
I don't know.
Okay.
That's it right now.
That's it? So, what else?
Lacey said thank you, guys.
You're welcome. So, what else do you want? What do you want to talk about?
I don't know. Go on a rant.
I can't go on rants. I can barely talk here. I think that it's important that people understand that, you know, we talk so much about corrections a lot. That's because everyone wants to fix problems. But I really, really want people to understand the amount of work that we should be doing with our dogs. What I'm seeing a lot of people do is over-talk to their dogs. That's one issue that's really, really big, is they're over-talking with their dogs. They're like really talking to them to get them to do something instead of actually showing them what they want them to do and then attaching a word to it and then proofing it. So getting a dog to lie down on command is a multi-day, multi-week, multi-step protocol. Then getting them to stay in command is a multi-step protocol over weeks and lots of proofing. Getting a reliable, for instance, when we teach the word down to a dog, we don't say no to it until we've showed them how to do it, and they've successfully done it 300 to 400 times. Like, so much work goes into these dogs. So much work. And I think what a lot of people are doing is they're not doing enough repetitions, they're not proofing their dogs, they're not proofing their dogs off distractions, and then what they're doing is they're putting their dogs in situations where they're always gonna fail and they haven't proofed the failure away from the real world. So what you wanna do is you wanna proof the dog failing in a controlled environment, so you can teach the dog what's to be expected, so you can actually do the dog training prior to the actual real life happening going on, so the dog is better prepared for the real world. Next.
Little Mom Mud, what's the best way to desensitize him to gunshots? I have to carry my 303. Should I tether and test long line?
Yeah. What you can do is in the house, just download gunshots. If you want to do that caliber, you can download gunshots from YouTube, start playing them, and then if you want to just start if you want to do food protocols while you're shooting, I mean, it's a pretty powerful gun. So what you can do is just start seeing how the dog responds to it. Maybe start using a smaller gun to start. Next.
Matt, my poodle, 2 years old, is jumping on people again after seemingly learned it wasn't okay. He seems to constantly challenge and push limits. What to do with him?
Most likely your punishment was not forceful enough. So there is a proper way how to punish a dog. It's possible that it wasn't forceful enough. Next.
JP, the video to John on your Instagram made me cry, Jeff. John, if you're lurking here, take your time, buddy, but please don't give up doing what you do best. I'll watch your videos.
Thank you. Who said that?
JP.
So JP, thank you for recognizing that. And I hope people... You know, it's so funny that if people want to know who I really am, that was real Jeff. So most people on this podcast see entertainment Jeff, but that's who I am. So, and that's how I feel too. And I think we've got a bigger issue out there in society with people. You know, there's a great, someone did write the quote, "The Man in the Arena." If you have not listened to "The Man in the Arena," it's a wonderful speech. I think Teddy Roosevelt did it. I don't know if he was the originator of it, but "The Man in the Arena" is a really good, I don't know if it's called a poem?
I don't know.
It's like a rant slash poem, but it's a wonderful, wonderful speech. Call it a speech then. It's maybe, you know what we should do? I should just read it when I'm not coughing. Let's just make a video of it. We'll just make a video of me reading Madden Arena, giving the person the proper credibility of who wrote that version of it. But it really pretty much talks to, and I really feel strongly about this, there's so many people that are not in the fucking arena. Like, if you're not in the arena working with the dogs that we do, doing the work that I do, your opinion, well, I don't care about anybody's opinion, but your comments and your opinions don't matter. Nope. They don't matter at all. They're invalid. I really don't give a shit what you have to think. And I think more people need to do that. It's like, first of all, if you want to sit in the seats and watch, that's really cool, but you get no say in any of this because you're not in the game. There's so many people that are not in the game, but they seem to fucking have big fucking mouths out there. I'm seeing it a lot. Today alone, I got three private, either, I guess they're DMs, they're all DMs. DMs are, even if it's not an Instagram, it's a message, it's still a DM on Facebook, right? Mm-hmm. Private message, PM. So, literally from people saying, wow, Jeff, I'm in a lot of dog training Facebook groups. I'm seeing a lot of hate on you lately. And I just want you to know it's a turnoff. So for all the people out, and just to let you guys know that I feel bad for you. I have massive empathy for you. People, and for other people that are starting their own businesses, I want people to understand that business is a combination of war and chess. Just remember that. For all my fellow business owners out there, if you want to do any mentoring with me at all, or any like work through struggles of like how to get through shit, people have to understand that owning a business is war and chess. And that's what it is. And it's not easy. In fact, we were sitting there today. We stopped. We had a little bit of free time, and we got an acai bowl. Thank you. I've eaten them before, but I didn't know how to pronounce it. An acai bowl, and we went to this tiny little 80 square foot acai stand, and it actually was probably one of the better ones I've ever tasted.
So good.
And I started chatting the woman up, and here she is in the middle of Oahu, you know, serving acai to mostly probably locals and tourists. There's not a lot of, we're on the north shore of the island, so there's not a huge tourist population. Airbnb, you're really fucked up on this one, just to let you know.
Yeah.
You're really fucked up on this one. So you really want to keep people impoverished. It's a great way to do what you guys just did. So for all the politicians on the island, you really fucked up the people of the north shore. So what it was, it's like, you see this, but it's like I started chatting her up. So she's got another store and then a food delivery system. So it all sounds good, but she's probably working 100 hours a week and probably hasn't been in the beach for a while. So
definitely.
Yeah, so I think it's interesting how...
She makes a damn good bowl.
But it's interesting. I think people have to realize how hard you need to work also to make a business run. So people say I work too much. I'm like, I don't work enough. There's no such thing as working too much. You know, next.
Mm-hmm. Lacey says, how do you feel about medication? I have Willow on fluoxetine. She was just after the attack. She was even fearful of people.
So, number one, I'm not anti-meds. I think we over, like, I don't do the flu shot. So, but
me
I was...
Either.
So...
Never gotten the flu.
So, actually, either have I. I'm sick now, but it's not the flu. Mm-hmm. So... I'm not against meds on dogs. I think we over-medicate our dogs. But I'm seeing dog training work way better than medication. Next.
Swanty said the owner wanted to get rid of the litter, so we decided to adopt one. So yeah, it probably is 4 weeks.
So it's probably 4 weeks. So I would still say be super careful. Just because the owner wanted to get rid of the litter. So just be really, really careful. That's really young. To get a dog. There's some good studies out there about dogs at 5 weeks, pre-5 weeks, 5 week syndrome, whether it's true or not. There's some developmental issues. So I don't know much about raising a dog at 4 weeks old because that's not my world. Next.
Mm. Cindy, hey guys, sometimes when I'm walking past strangers with my dog on leash, she starts to freak out and tries to run. What should I do? Thank you.
Well, you've got control over your dog, hopefully, so don't let her. Keep her in a proper heel. So I don't know what your heel looks like. If your heel looks like your dog is not next to you, like theoretically, if your dog's in a proper heel next to you, how can it heal? How can it try to flee? So I know what it looks like. So keep it in a proper heel next. And don't say anything.
Britt, how do you feel about jogging on the walk? Can it make your dog anxious?
No, they're absolutely 100% not connected. And anybody that says that they would be is just silliness. That's foolish. That's wrong information. There's no connection whatsoever. Next.
Little Mama Mud, he ignores the sounds inside, and I've shot the pistol out the door while he was crated. No fear for it, but walking down trails might be different.
It might be. There's interior and exterior behavior. There's only one way to find out. Next.
Matt.
And don't, what are you doing shooting your gun inside?
No, out the front door.
Yeah, but still. Okay. It's gonna be so loud. It got to echo. Inside a home. Next.
Well, there's no rules up there, obviously.
No, there isn't any rules.
Do whatever she wants. Matt, when I walk my poodle off leash, he often charges at other dogs. He's big and I'm afraid he might hurt the other dog. Should I remote collar him on high before he reaches the other dog?
No, you should keep your dog on a leash. Step one, don't walk your dog off leash. Because if your dog rushes my dog, I'm going to kick it. And I'm not saying this to be mean, but it's like any dog that rushes my dog gets kicked. And I have the right to kick it. And so does somebody else. The last thing I want you to do is, number one, if you know your dog has a bad behavior, who's this, John?
That is Matt.
So Matt, let me call you on your stuff, buddy, out of all respect. You're being irresponsible, right? You know your dog rushes other dogs off leash, but it's off leash. Keep it on a leash. It could drag a long line. If you want to experience off leash, you know, stuff, let it drag a long line so you can grab it before it does it. But if your dog rushed up to me and you shocked it as it was rushing, it probably would continue to rush at me because you haven't trained it recall. That's not what shock collars are used for. Yes, they can be used for recall under high levels of distraction, but first train your dog how to recall. Next.
Britt. Sorry, last one. You said that, I think, your last one, Britt.
So we'll pretend we're not going to hear that comment, that part of it.
Last week, my neighbors were in the garage. They said they don't like my dog when she's not done anything to them. They have a small dog. Funny, I could say the same.
Right. Okay, so what you really meant to say is you have rude neighbors. So the moral of the story is you have rude neighbors. Okay, next.
Magic Larry, Pee-wee says hello from South Carolina. Hope you're well and can enjoy the weather there in Hawaii.
Thank you, Pee-wee. Thank you, Magic Larry.
Hey, Magic Larry and Pee-wee. Matt, when you put your dog in heel, do you use the command heel?
No, I use the command down. Matt, come on, buddy. Actually, I say Fuß because I've trained my dogs in German. But the word doesn't matter. Teaching the proper heel, you teach the proper heel first, then you attach the word. You can use any word you want. But if you want to use the word heel, heel would be the word. But what's more important than any word out there in dog training is the actual training. So train your dog exactly where heel is. And to me, that's a little bit behind my leg, with the dog in the follow mode. And then I use the word Fuß, which it doesn't matter what word you use, but yes, you would use the word heel. Heel is the standard word that is used to walk at my side, walk at my pace, no sniffing, no marking, turn where I am. When I come to a stop, you automatically stop and sit, stay right in my leg. That's the standard definition of heel. Next.
JP, have you ever had to kick a rushing dog ever yet to protect yourself?
Yes, I have, many times. Not just to protect myself, but to protect my dogs, to protect my kids. Absolutely. I've kicked all sizes of dogs. I take no pride in that. I don't feel good about it. I don't think, look at me, you know, but it's just like, if a dog's going to the vet, it's not going to be my dog. it's not going to be my dog. And possibly I save that dog from rushing other people's dogs. That's just the way it is. That's a standard thing. It's just it's a standard operating protocol to do when a dog rushes you, is you boot it, because it could be a horrific outcome. A horrific outcome. And it's got nothing to do with if your dog is friendly or not. Number one, your dog is on a leash. The chances of a friendly dog that's on a leash turning to unfriendly dramatically increase. The fact that a dog is rushing it dramatically increases. I won't take a chance until you have actually seen and experienced and been in not a dog fight where you can just separate them or yell, but a real, real dog fight where if there's no human interaction, a dog will fucking die. You don't understand the concept of neutralizing threats. And I will never take a chance because they all start out looking good. And it's not a breed issue. The friendliest golden can shred your fucking dog. So it could be a size issue. I mean, if a little dachshund rushes up to my dog, I'm not worried really much about my dog being injured, but my dog could lose the skin of his nose, could get a puncture wound, that could get infected. So to me, any rushing animal is a threat. Next.
Matt says, let me clarify. My poodle is charging at other dogs that are a friend's dog and is in an enclosed area like their yard.
Oh, okay. So you're not as much of a dick anymore, Matt. So let me clarify then. Still don't shock your dog. What you do is train recall, and you can proof your dog over that. But the last thing I want anyone to be doing, anyone, is to an untrained dog on recall, give a high level or any level of stimulation on the remote collar. That's not how you use a remote collar. You train the dog on the remote collar first before you use it. You don't introduce the collar for a rushing dog. Now, can you use a remote collar with no training? Sure. Counter surfing. I'm reaching towards the counter. We're staying at an Airbnb right now. Counter's over there. So counter surfing, getting in the trash, getting in the litter box, eating poop, fence fighting, digging a hole. I got a few other things. You can use it with no training. But recall, if you expect the dog to come flying back to you, you actually have to train recall. Next.
Little Mom Mud, but hubby says I have to take the rifle or I can't walk. Too many close calls. We'll run him with the snowmobile first, then tether him to it and shoot maybe. Arthritis means I can't run anymore.
Yeah, definitely. Smart hubby. But you, even if your hubby didn't tell you that, Little Mama Mud, you'd still take the gun. Mm-hmm. You know you would. You love that gun too much. Next.
Taryn says, hi, Jeff.
Hey, how are you?
Matt, I meant to say heel or just have him in the position. Do you always say heel or just do it?
Historically, I just do it. My dogs know when we're walking outside, especially on a leash, they're in heel. Next.
Taryn, how do you bonk a 4-pound chihuahua? Is it possible? I only see you bonk big dogs.
Well, I work with small dogs. Actually, at my last seminar, I worked with a min pin, which was probably about 9 pounds, and I bonked that dog. I actually used the same bonker I was using on all the other dogs. I didn't bonk it as hard, but you can use a washcloth. The question is, do you stop a 4-pound dog from an unwanted behavior? That's the question, right? So yes, you do. How do you stop a 4-pound dog from an unwanted behavior? Through the application of a punisher. What punisher is going to be used? That's the magic. So you've got to figure out the punisher that's going to be used. A bonker could be used, but you can use a rolled up dish rag. You can use something smaller. So, you know, you obviously would have to tailor it because it's a much more fragile dog, but the dog still, you still don't want an annoying 4-pound dog. Next.
Sean, I started socializing my German Shepherd puppy since he was 4 months old, and he's been great until he turned 6 months.
Yes.
Now he won't stop barking at other dogs. How do I train him moving forward?
Okay. So you're going to see another change at 9 months and a year old, and then another one at 18 months old. So the barking is normal. It's not acceptable, but it's normal. So what do? Remote collar, no, correct. Next.
Lacey said, use a hand towel.
Yes, you're probably talking about the four-pound dog, yeah.
Matt, my poodle has good recall. My question is really that he's rough when playing with some dogs. Is there a way to have him less rough?
Yes, excellent. Okay, but so you didn't tell me all this stuff three questions ago, okay? So you didn't
we're getting more.
So like we're getting more. I didn't know your dog had recall. So now here, but let me add another thing to this. Does your dog have good recall after being corrected high? So, and I'm being serious here. The way that remote collar training works is hundreds and hundreds of reps go into it. Then you have to proof your dog off a high level correction. Now, knowing that the dogs are in a fenced in area, keep a long line on the dog, let the dog run, and then yes, correct high. But how many repetitions? Have you done hundreds of repetitions on that remote collar? Have you gone from continuous stim to non-compliant stim, which is NCS stim, on that? Does a dog know what a high correction feels like in any other context? So all these things are important. The remote collar stim at a high level doesn't say, come back. All it says is, that really sucked. For all we know, your dog will drop into a down or run the other way. So keep a long line on your dog. Next.
KS, I've been away for a bit. Where were y'all? You look like you've been in the sun or wind or something.
So right now we're in Oahu, Hawaii. We're here three times a week. So we were just in Austin, Texas. We flew into Oahu.
You made that sound weird. We're here three times a week. We're not in Hawaii three times a week. We're doing our show three times a week.
No, we're going to start coming back here three times a week.
Okay, cool.
Okay.
Get on board with
we
that.
Do our show three times a week. So right now we're in Oahu. We arrived yesterday or the day before. We arrived yesterday. Yeah, we arrived yesterday around lunchtime. And we're here through Monday. We're here through Monday.
We just have really bad lighting, you guys.
Yeah, the lighting really sucks.
Not good.
Yeah, I brought my lighting with me, but we set it up not... I don't think the lighting looks that bad.
It's making us look really red.
Oh, not. That probably is the sun.
No, this is like what was going on in your office that one night on that one show.
Okay.
Like, oh my God, we look so red. It's because we have all the warm colors.
Okay, why don't you stay there?
It should be cooler.
I'll switch it to a little bit cool. Okay, talk about something.
What are we going to talk about?
Talk about your acai bowl.
If you guys have ever had acai bowls, they're really good. My God, now we look like we're on stage for Cirque. It's really right. Hold on. That's better. Is that what we had before,
That's
though?
That's what we had before.
Guys, I don't know. I don't know how to make it better. Now it's really dark. Whoa. Just leave it like that. That's fine. That's cooler. That's good. Okay. So anyway, Little Mom Mud said, I haven't, too heavy, I was taking the banger, but that won't work with a pack of nine wolves or a mom and cubs. I just never tell him, I leave it at home.
Jeez.
Ooh, what's a banger? Sounds pretty dangerous.
Yeah.
Intense gun.
Which uses to take down fucking polar bears.
And packs of wolves,
yeah.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, she lives out there. Next. I think this lighting's worse, by the way.
JP, could a brand new roll of paper towels work as a bonker?
No, it can't. A bonker is a bonker is a bonker. Watch the video.
It's because you're sitting too close. Sit back.
Okay. It's a towel.
There you go.
What you can do is make the towel. First of all, anything can be used as a bonker. So I guess you could. A shoe can, a throw pillow can. But make yourself an official bonker out of a roll of towels. A rolled up towel. Next.
Dan, hey, I need help badly. My husky hound is 4 years old now. She has terrible separation anxiety, so bad that she has chewed through three metal wire cages. I have tried your videos to calm her down. She has hurt herself in the wire cages and destroyed them. Now she's in a closed plastic crate. She is better, but still trying to rip it apart.
Okay, so you should do a Skype with me because it sounds like you're desperate for help and you're only going to get 1/100th of the answer on this show. But number one, there's a lot of stuff you can be doing to stop your dog should have a remote collar on in the crate, and you should be correcting all that behavior. Teach your dog how to do an incredible down in the crate. do lots of calming exercises, which isn't like massage, it's like obedience. Yes, you do a proper amount of exercise with your dog. A lot of people say exercise your dog more. That doesn't stop separation anxiety. It doesn't need toys. It doesn't need chew things. It needs to learn how to do nothing in the crate. But the act of punishing the separation of the destruction is how you stop all that. But I'd recommend you doing a Skype, because there's probably a bunch of other things during the day that are actually not going well either. Next.
Little Mom Mud said, that's why Finn has a cowbell and remote collar on walks. Damn moose are cranky out here too. So if he runs, I can hear him and recall with the remote. Smarter walking now.
Awesome. Good for you.
Cranky moose.
Yeah, moose too.
Freaking cranky.
Moose, packs of wolves, and polar bears.
Damn.
Yep.
Dan, she has hurt herself. I already read that. Chaos. Oh, awesome. I'm in SA. What's SA? I wanted to attend your seminar, but couldn't make the dates.
Oh, that's too bad.
What's SA?
I was thinking about Southeast Asia.
South Austin?
South Austin, maybe. Yep.
I don't know.
Yep. Well, we'll be in Austin next November and 14th, 15th next.
KS said, it was the lighting, but y'all's faces are nice and tan. Looking good. Wish I was there.
Yep.
Yeah, that lighting was horrific. This is what we usually do at work, is the mix of light and cool.
Oh, cool.
FYI. Okay. Don't ever do all warm.
Okay.
All warm, bad.
Got it. Well, the light. Each light. Just light and cool.
You are really sick.
When I'm talking.
Oh my God. Yeah, and you have a seminar to do.
I know.
Lacey says, y'all are beautiful in any light.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lacey. Michelle, super glad to see you guys. No questions. Smooth sailing here.
Thank you.
Matt, when you say 300 to 400 reps for a given command for practicing this, would you recommend a given amount of reps per training session per day?
Well, whatever we're, excuse me, Matt. Oh my God, sorry.
Oh my God. We're ending this at 8.
Okay. So Matt, whatever works for you. Whatever works for you. 20 to 30. Next.
Susan, how many hours a day can I leave a prong collar on my dog while training off and on throughout the day?
Well, if there's no leash attached to the dog, technically the dog doesn't need the collar on. But it also depends on your dog's sensitivity to it. Some dogs have got no fur, they can't wear the collar as long. Next.
Tara, I just found your podcast recently. So much great advice and information. I'm learning so much. Thank you.
Awesome, Tara. Yeah, welcome.
We're cool. I'm glad people learned something from this show.
We're at 616, and there's about 3 years of podcasts that are not in there. Plus, there's 6 years of radio shows that are not in there.
Wait, in the beginning, you weren't saving your podcast?
I don't know what happened to them. I think we lost a bunch. I don't know. Something happened with the transferring them.
You guys, I made fish tacos for dinner. They were great. Tell the people how good they were.
Next question.
Handmade from scratch.
She caught the fish.
I did.
Killed it.
Skinned it.
Scaled it.
Fried it up.
It was fantastic. It was marlin. Should have seen her, that marlin at the end of the line. Should have seen her. Yeah. Right from the beach.
Right from the freaking shelf in the grocery store. Packaged. Good to go.
She was the only one in the grocery store with a fishing line. The only one. She looked a little bit silly.
I was trying to make it authentic.
That's right.
I'm like, caught me a good one.
She cast it. The hook went right into the plastic, into the styrofoam.
Yep.
Reeled it right in. It was dangling.
Yep.
It was dangling. Next.
KS is San Antonio, Texas. Sorry, guys. Didn't mean to make the lighting a thing. LOL.
It's okay.
It's okay. Now we know. Michelle says he needs a nebulizer. Yeah, you do.
Okay.
A nebulizer.
Next.
And a neti pot. Dan, great info. So when I keep her in her cage, should I correct her every time she bites the cage or barks? By correcting, do I give a little smack or poke?
Sure. Smack, poke, shock, bonk, rattle the cage, earthquake the cage. All this stuff sounds harsh, but it fixes all these problems. It's not like you've got to do it forever. We had a dog at our last seminar in Austin that wouldn't shut up in the crate.
Oh, yeah, I think it would not shut up.
And I walked over to the crate. I picked up the crate, picked it up, dropped it, picked it up, shook it, dropped it again, walked away. No words. Guess what? For a day and a half, the dog didn't make a peep.
Yep.
For a day and a half. I mean, it went home. It went back in the next day. Not one peep. Folks, you've got to understand, when you properly correct a dog, it's not like you're doing it every day. And if you keep having to do it, you're actually not correcting the dog. You're nagging the dog. And what most people are doing is, most people are their own worst enemies. They're working against themselves because they're putting too much emotion into it. There was this funny study that somebody emailed me, and it was titled, "How Negative Reinforcement Training is Worse for the Dog because it increases their cortisone levels." And they're like, they took 50 dogs from positive training schools.
I read that article.
And 50 dogs from aversive training schools. And they found out that yanking on the collar and yelling was worse. And I'm like, number one, we never ever yell at dogs, and we rarely yank on collars. So your study, plus the study was flawed.
Yeah.
It was not an actual scientific study. So it was not an unbiased study. It was already predetermined from the beginning just by who sponsored it. So the point of this being is like, since when did yelling, first of all, the lack of tools encourages you to yell. In fact, most positive dog trainers, they encourage owners to sound mad.
They make it emotional.
They go, sound mad at your dog. Turn your back on your dog.
Yep.
Make it look like you're mad at your dog. Why? Because you don't have tools to utilize it. Be angry at your dog. This is what they teach you.
And you bring all this emotion into it.
And then what they do is they tell you to be emotional. In true dog training, it's unemotional. It's matter of fact. Yep, that was good. Nope, that was wrong. But they like negative reinforcement training, yelling. Well, so you're comparing yelling to a shock collar? Give me a break.
Right.
Next.
Yelling's worse. I'd rather get shocked than have somebody yell at me.
Yep.
Lacey says fish tacos are the best.
They are.
JP, have you ever met Frank Caprio from the Caprio Show? Seems like a good guy from Providence.
Yeah. Didn't you ask? Somebody asked that last time. Yeah.
I don't even know who that is.
Yep. Next.
Lou, hi J&J. Can you please explain the difference between a 225 and the other size prong collars?
Yeah.
Is it the length of the poking out bit or what? Can't buy them here, so I can't look to work it out.
Yeah, look online though. 225, okay, their measurements, 2.25 millimeters and 3 millimeters are the two sizes we use. 1.75 we use for the tiny dogs. So each little link, which are separated, are different sizes. They're different sizes. So they're different lengths and widths. And the thickness of the steel is also different. So it's a size difference. Historically, dogs under 50 pounds or 20 to 22 kilos are the 225, and dogs over that are 3. No dog that we train, even a 200-pound dog, needs above a 3-millimeter prong collar. But they sell up to like a 4.75, which I don't know what dog you would put that on. Next.
Matt, my dogs go crazy in the car when they see another dog on the street. What would you recommend?
One dog at a time. Do one dog at a time. Put it in the car. Put a remote collar on the dog. Let the dog know that behavior sucks. Next.
Lou, hi J&J. Please can you... I already read that. Lacey, thanks for taking the time to do this. Feel better, Jeff.
I will. You're welcome.
Dan, interesting. I'll try this, but the dog is pretty crazy. I've never seen this dog so addicted to someone. Me. It's almost like she's possessed as soon as I leave, but I will be a little more harsh with this training. I have no problem doing that. Thanks again.
It's not just the harshness, Dan. It's the consistency. So just to let you know, we see this daily. We see this daily, and we stop it daily. Yeah. We see this at our seminars every time I do a seminar, and we stop it in the first 15 minutes, live in front of everybody. So the last seminar in Austin, there was 22 dogs there. By 9:30, all the dogs were laying down. We had to address whining here or there. By after lunch, which was from 1 to 2, from 2 o'clock on, no dogs made a peep. All the second day, all the dogs were quiet in their crates. Every one of these dogs has a problem. Not every dog. Many of these dogs have problems with crate nonsense at home. We fixed it. We stopped it live. I showed everybody how to do it. It's highly effective. Next.
JP, Joelle, if you don't know who Frank Caprio is, that's a good thing. But knowing him isn't a bad thing either.
No. Joelle's not a native Rhode Islander. She's only been in there for Rhode Island in a year.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she also doesn't watch television or listen to traditional radio. Either do I. I just know him because I used to have a radio show, and I've been in Rhode Island for 35 years. Next.
That's it. And it's 8 o'clock.
Okay. We're going to end this show here, guys, because I'm having a really hard time talking. And it's also, we're exhausted.
Yeah.
But I want to thank everybody for jumping in, for asking your questions. This weekend, we've got a wonderful seminar in Oahu. You can go to Jeff Gellman Seminars to see our seminar schedule. Thank you so much. Also, for everybody out there, remember, be nice. And for all the people that are out there that are being hateful and writing hateful comments online, number one, karma's a bitch. If any of you out there have got, if any of you out there that are parents, how dare you bully people online? How dare you participate in online bullying? If somebody was online bullying your child, you would be mad. You are doing that. Number two, some karma is a bitch. I don't want to be negative or morbid here, but you are trying to cause harm to another person through your words. You have got loved ones. The way the universe works is you're going to pay the price. God forbid something horrific happens to your loved ones and the universe connects it to your online behavior. That's how things work. Now, if any of you are out there struggling because something bad in your life is happening, and if you feel like you need to be mean because of that, what I'd like you to do is talk to somebody about that. It doesn't help. That's not part of the recovery process. What you're doing is you're taking your anger out on others. I'm sorry that something bad has happened to you in your life. I'm sorry something that is bad has happened to you. But the best way is to be nice. Being nice wins. What we're seeing right now is it's really easy to be hateful. It's really easy. But what you're doing is you're not helping the process any. It actually takes effort to be hateful, and it takes effort to be nice. Being nice can be easy. Make it easy. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, madly in love with you. We'll see you. We're probably going to do a Friday night show. Mm-hmm. We're going to do a Friday night show. Say Wednesday?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're going to do a Friday night show. Let's do it earlier.
Yeah.
We'll do it. You think we can do it by 5? I doubt it.
Probably not.
Probably 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock. Maui time, which is 11 p.m. Maui time, Hawaiian time. No disrespect to Oahu, I love you. Which is 11 p.m. East Coast time. All right, madly in love with you. Talk to you later.
Good night.
Bye-bye.